awesome.
Okay, so then they then sent three ships with the governor, Mr. Jan van Riebeeck. He came with his French-born wife, Maria della Quellari, and they came here in full force to start a refreshment station. So now, the Dutch, that is why it's called the Mother City. So this was the first place discovered by the Dutch. Then, the Dutch also introduced slavery to the Cape in 1658. They introduced slavery to the Cape.
Oh, question. You said they discovered it? The Dutch discovered it?
Yes.
So was it people already here before they came?
No, only the local people.
So they basically discovered it for their people.
Yes.
Invaded us. Don't use the word discover.
Yes. Rock was, on.
There was a white invasion.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
But
that's how we think also.
Okay, right.
Okay.
But they landed here. Discovery, invaded, all the same thing.
No, they discovered their country.
Okay, invaded.
We were already here.
They took over our land.
He's giving us their history to us. Right. That so is not the history.
Words. Okay.
Yeah. Well, stop her if it's not the history.
I like this man, yo.
Okay, invaded.
Yes.
Quite right.
Yes.
So they arrived here. They started the refreshment station. They then also introduced slavery to the Cape. Okay? The slaves had a code of conduct. The slaves came from East Africa, West Africa,
or stolen Africans.
Your people?
They were actually stolen Africans. Or enslaved Africans. Those are the terminology. Because we have a conscious group of Africans from the diaspora.
Yes.
And they want you to...
From India, from Malaysia, Madagascar, Ceylon. So when the slaves, when they arrived
when
here...
When stolen Africans...
They had an auction. They would put the slave on a bucket. And there would be... The slaves were sold to the highest bidders. Okay? So, they also, the terminology that comes from kick the bucket, it comes from here. Because when the slaves disobeyed their masters, they would be put on a bucket, they would take a rope, tie it around the slave's neck with a knot in the nape of the neck, tie it to the tree and simply kick the bucket. The slaves had a code of conduct. My great-great-grandmothers come from India. We are all part of the slave history. So I've got a Dutch grandfather, a Scottish grandfather, and two Indian grandmothers, great-great-grandmothers. So this is how the colored person also came about.
Right.
So now the code of conduct, they had to walk bare feet, the slaves. They had to wear straw hats so that they would be recognized and differentiated between the masters and the slaves. They would be hung if they were disobedient, and they also, slavery was started by the Dutch, and it was ended by the British. On the 31st of December 1834, slavery was abolished. So, of course, after slavery, we had segregation, apartheid, where we then had a white government ruling
majority of black people
making all the rules and regulations, and this is also then how apartheid all started. There was also a Group Areas Act that was drawn up in 1950, a Group Areas Act, and then in the year 1966
1950,
the Group Areas Act was drawn up. So in 1966, this Group Areas Act came into action. Our government marked areas that was reserved now only for the white folk of the country. And they had to, there was an area in Cape Town where we're going now, it's actually called District 6. And this area was one of the areas that was allocated for the white people of the country. Every place with mountain and ocean views was all reserved for white people. So instructions were given that thousands and thousands of people had to move out of these areas where they were living in. My family lived in an area called Goodwood, which was also then in 1966 declared a white area. We had electricity, we had a big house, we had a washroom inside of the house, and electricity, water, running water, hot water. And we were then told to pack our things and move out. So in all of the areas, people packed up all their belongings, their family, their everything, and they moved out of the areas without any reimbursement financially, because those areas were now all declared white areas. And the area that District 6 was one of the areas that was also declared a white area, and the people in District 6 decided, we are not going to move out. It was a vibrant community of people of all walks of life living in District 6, and they decided, we are not moving out of this area, we are going to stay here. And of course the government sent in bulldozers and they bulldozed down all the houses of these people. So this was a very, very sad time in South Africa. And of course, Mr. Nelson Mandela, Madiba, he is the man that, and all his followers, was the man that made the huge difference in South Africa. So he went and caused big ructions, which will, Thando will tell you more about that later on. And of course he spent 18 years at Robben Island from 1964 until 1982. He was at Robben Island, and he was then also, he got very ill on the island, he was very sick. He even, his tear ducts was damaged so badly that he could not even shed a tear towards the last years of his life.
Yeah, from the limestone we found out why.
Yes, from the limestone, because they sat outside.
Yes.
And they had to make the mortar with the rocks, and this is how, after all those years, his eyes was, besides his chest and bronchial and all of those severe illnesses. So he was very, very sick, and he was then moved to Robben Island, which was to Paulsmoor Prison for 7 years, from 82 till 88, and that is where he, that was a high security prison with murderers and the rest. And then of course the last 2 years he was at Victor Verster Prison, it's now called the Drakenstein Prison out in the Paarl area, and that is where he spent the last 2 years of his 27 years in prison. And also the reason why he spent the last 2 years at Victor Verster, it was a petty theft prison. And pardon me, the reason why he went there, and he was in a house, he was in one of the warden's homes and not in the prison itself, because our last white president, Mr. F.W. de Klerk, needed a place of comfort to negotiate, operative word, to negotiate his release. And on the 11th of February 1990, he took the long walk to freedom. He titled his book, The Long Walk to Freedom, reason being, the prison is here, long road, and he had to walk out the prison to the gates.
Yeah, with Winnie, by his side.
That's right.
Yes.
We know history, we know some things.
I know, you know, the people that come from America, they all know, especially the African Americans, they all know the story. So here we are now.
Can you also tell the audience and those who will be watching this video that the name Nelson was given by the white people because they didn't want to pronounce his legal name? So can you share what his legal name is?
Okay, we'll get the pronunciation here from Tandu.
Yeah, Tandu, okay.
Look at the camera then. And this is also where we're going to get off now. Just the name.
Whose name is Khorishlashla?
You can pronounce it.
Khorishlashla.
Khorishlashla.
Khorishlashla. The one that's going to give you a
Khorishlashla. Khorishlashla.
Okay,
we're going to get out here now. This is the District 6 Museum.
Okay.
And then when we leave here, we're going to lunch in Khayelitsha.
Yes.
And we'll take it from there.
Okay.
Bye, Dad.